This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Introduction. Talk to Her, Habel Connella, 2002 is a vastly rich and interesting film which begs to be analyzed in depth. The film won the 2003 Oscar for Best Original Screenplay and has been hailed as Almodóvar's masterpiece. The film offers much both in terms of thematic analysis and micro-analysis of the sound, performance, cinematography, editing and mise-en-scène. Like most of Almodóvar's films, little is clear-cut, the characters are complex and our affinity and empathy for them shifts throughout the film. Almodóvar is Spain's most famous, prolific and celebrated contemporary director, and any study of his films cannot be complete without considering the social context of Spain. In a style which has been referred to as postmodernist, Talk to Her's Spain is a mongrel, a mix of the traditional and modern. Spanish guitars and bullfighting mingle with a hyperreal mishmash of 60s wallpaper, expressive dance and crass TV chat shows. Almodóvar can be considered to be a director who is a specialist in gender, and the issue of gender identity is explored in Talk to Her, particularly the notion that gender characteristics are fluid and not fixed. Almodóvar's characters simultaneously embody and reject gender stereotypes and share both feminine and masculine attributes. The film contains themes present within many of Almodóvar's films, such as loneliness, communication, the impossibility of a romantic relationship, and psychology. Physicality and the body are central to Almodóvar's films and particularly to Talk to Her, a film which explores both the active and passive body. Further to this, the issue of spectatorship is important in relation to how the body is presented to and interpreted by the spectator, and how this gaze at times celebrates, sexualizes, objectifies and medicalizes the human form, especially the nude. Almodóvar self-consciously both celebrates and rejects traditional genre and narrative conventions, and as such, the film offers a rich opportunities for analysis in these frameworks. The film can be considered simultaneously both genreless and rich with conventions from many genres. Almodóvar's attitude to narrative structure is playful, winding backwards and forwards in time through the two relationships. Most of all, what makes Talk to Her such an interesting film to dissect is the uneasy position that Almodóvar places the spectator in, and how its messages and values create moral ambiguity. The film delivers morally complex, hazy messages about rape, voyeurism and obsession, and consequently, the spectator finds humor where they should find revulsion and sympathy where they should find anger. Our attitudes towards characters and events can change dramatically from first screening to close analysis. As a result, the film has sparked a great deal of critical, theoretical, and philosophical analysis, particularly around the issue of rape. The film was generally well received by critics and audiences, and there is an extensive amount of analysis of the film from a range of different perspectives, from bloggers to philosophers, psychologists to dance performance theorists. The aim of this book is to bring together many of the interpretations and discourses surrounding the film in a readable and easy to digest way. Just as the last lines of the film are "nothing is simple," so too, the whole film can be thought of as complicated. However, it is within the complexity of the film that one can find the most interest in the film. So much of the visual symbolism and the dialogue from the Oscar-winning screenplay within the film is polysemic, and in this book I aim to suggest different interpretations rather than focusing on one argument or point of view. One of the great things about studying Almodóvar's films is that they are wide open to interpretation, and, as the reader of this book, I hope that you will be able to form your own opinions on the messages, genre, narrative, characters and themes of Talk to Her, as well as engaging with notions of authorship, spectatorship and the Spanish historical and social context. As Almodóvar said, "One of the wonderful things about film is that it can be seen in a thousand different ways, all of them real. You have to be flexible with a movie and with life in general. You have to be tolerant and you have to have a sense of humor, and you don't have to accept things on face value." References. 1. www.rollingstone.com/movies/reviews/talk-to-her-2002105. Access the 10th of September 14. 2. http://www.filmmakermagazine.com/archives/issues/spring1994/pedro.php-vbcxapldxig. Accessed the 8th of September 14. Almodóvar as an auteur. Paul Julian Smith refers to Almodóvar as the one true auteur to emerge from the 80s, and Martin DeLugo refers to him as an undisputable international auteur. Auteur was a word first used in France in the 1960s, where writers of the film magazine Cahiers du Cinéma coined the term to describe a growing number of directors whom they considered to have a signature style across several of their films. This signature could be in the form of a visual style through reoccurring motifs and techniques within the cinematography, mise-en-scène or editing, or through sound themes, representations, genre, narrative, or the inclusion of similar characters. There seems to be overwhelming evidence to suggest that, across the 19 feature films made up until 2013, Almodóvar has defining and reoccurring tropes in all of these categories. Throughout the book, there will be constant reference to the qualities and characteristics of Talk to Her that adhere to Almodóvar's auteur style. However, it is important to understand where some of the qualities and characteristics of his work emerge from. Almodóvar in historical and social context. Almodóvar made his first appearance as a filmmaker in the late 70s, during a period of immense cultural and political upheaval. However, the story of the Spanish film industry as a whole is equally turbulent. While the early days of the moving image from the late 19th century up until 1935 were much the same in Spain as they were in the rest of Western Europe, the change from an agricultural society to an industrial one in Spain was slower. As a consequence, much of the early Spanish cinema industry centered around the cities of Madrid and Barcelona, with filmmakers such as Luis Buñuel, director of Viridiana, 1961, see the section on rape in Spanish cinema, finding artistic success. Many of the films of this early era were, as Jordan and Allenson note, involved in recycling deep span, i.e. films heavy in Spanish iconography. This early tradition may have been an influence on Almodóvar's own recycling of Spanish iconography in Talk to Her. As Sally Faulkner notes, the introduction of sound was disastrous for this developing Spanish cinema, with many filmmakers moving to Hollywood to take part in this new emerging technology. Sound also posed a problem for European cinema more generally. With so many different languages in Europe, films were hard to export and share between different countries. In 1931, only one Spanish film was made as audiences turned to the technological spectacle of imported Hollywood sound cinema. Equally, the film industry was affected by the impact of the Great Depression upon the Spanish economy. In the mid-1930s, the industry had picked up again, with film production companies like Filmofono and CIFESA beginning to make more Spanish films for Spanish audiences. This peak was short-lived. The outbreak of civil war in 1936 saw a huge change in the film industry, with film now being a powerful tool for political propaganda. The Spanish Civil War, 1936-39, was fought between the nationalists who supported General Francisco Franco, allied with the fascist regimes of Mussolini in Italy and Hitler in Germany, who believed in traditional values of religion, monarchy and preserving Spanish national identity, versus the Republicans, supported by France and Great Britain, who supported the democratically elected Spanish Republic Party. The war was brutal, taking an approximate 500,000 victims and shaking the foundations of Spanish society. Franco and his fascist nationalist party won and brought in a nationalist regime which lasted for nearly 40 years until his Franco's death in 1975. Under the regime, people who criticized society and politics were often imprisoned. Religions other than Catholicism were not tolerated, and elements that were considered un-Spanish were repressed. As a consequence, sports like bullfighting and dances like the flamenco were heavily promoted. Regional languages and dialects were no longer officially recognized, in an attempt to try and build a single Spanish national identity. Whereas by the 50s and 60s, women in the rest of Western Europe were gaining greater independence, particularly within the realm of education and employment, Franco's regime encouraged traditional family units where women took on more domestic roles. Homosexuality was illegal and legalized after Franco's death in 1979. Films and all other cultural output in Spain had to pass strict censorship rules, and any content that seemed to criticize the regime or have anti-Catholic, communist, liberal, or gender-progressive messages was subject to censorship. Jordan and Allinson describe some of the censorship problems facing filmmakers during the Franco era. Film censorship was rolled out nationwide after July 1939. Within its remit were tasks such as the pre-censorship of all submitted film scripts, the approval of shooting scripts and exhibition licenses for Spanish films, the imposition of cuts and changes to sound and image tracks in completed films, the authorization of subtitling or dubbing plus film classification. Despite this, the Franco regime did recognize the potential of film in reflecting Spanish national identity, and during the 1960s, government-sponsored film schools were set up such as the Official Film School. As Faulkner notes, the Franco regime was keen for film to be a medium of quality, and as such, many Spanish films were made with the intention that they be entered into foreign film festivals such as Cannes. The whole system was filled with bureaucracy, and as a consequence, born in 1949, the films that Almodóvar would have watched in his youth would either have been those that gave a biased, uncritical, traditional vision of Spain, or they would have been foreign, mainly American films that did not challenge the ideology of the Franco regime. La Movida Madrilena. Franco's death in 1975 not only caused immense political upheaval, in the formation of a new democratic system of government, but also led to a cultural movement, La Movida Madrilena. Almodóvar was at the heart of the movement, which was typified by experimentation in gender identity, youth culture, color, cultural innovation, and the popularity of 60s and 70s pop art and punk styles in fashion and interior decor. Paula Willoughby Maricandi described La Movida as a rising new Spanish mentality, bent on overcoming boundaries and taboos. The period was a reaction against all that had repressed under Franco. It was an era of hedonism, creative expression, tolerance of new kinds of subcultures and sexual orientations. Almodóvar describes this era. It's difficult to speak of La Movida and explain it to those who didn't live those years. We weren't a generation, we weren't an artistic movement, we weren't a group with a concrete ideology. We were simply a bunch of people that coincided in one of the most explosive moments in the country. Almodóvar was a central part of the La Movida Madrilena movement, both in its instigation and in chronicling its development. He wrote comic books and sung in a glam rock parody band alongside Fabio McNamara. He directed and acted in his own short films made on Super 8 cameras, which were shown at parties and bars in Barcelona and the city at the heart of La Movida, Madrid. He wrote articles about the movement for the newspaper El País and countercultural magazines such as Vibraciones, thus arguably giving the movement more social and cultural recognition and significance. He directed his first feature-length film 5 years after Franco's death. Pepe, Lucci, Bomb and Other Girls on the Heap, 1980, is a riotous collage of hedonism, sexual exploration and the punk aesthetic, which reflects the party culture and sexual openness of the New Madrid. Similarly, his 1987 film Law of Desire explores the impact of La Movida by exploring the growing openness to different sexual experiences, notably orgies, and the growing tolerance towards homosexuality by featuring gay relationships. La Movida and the general shift in politics and culture had a huge impact on the gender roles in Spanish society. Almodóvar grew up in a very female-centered and led community, which was in contrast to the patriarchal nature of Franco-led society across Spain. Although his father was a constant figure in his life, it is for the majority of his films, his mother and his sisters, whom he seems to be more inspired by. As Susie McKenzie states, Almodóvar's entire career has been devoted to subverting images of power. The image of power for much of Almodóvar's childhood would have been male in the form of the Franco regime, the Civil Guard, Franco's military police force, and the Catholic Church. Like many of Almodóvar's other films such as High Heels, 1991, All About My Mother, 1999, Bad Education, 2004, and The Skin I Live In, 2011, Talk to Her deals with the refusal to accept traditional gender roles, which can be considered a central and defining feature of Almodóvar's auteur status. Whilst the hedonism and excess of some of his earlier films are somewhat repressed in Talk to Her, there are hints of La Movida's influence in some of the secondary characters, such as the flamboyant talk show host and through the mise-en-scène and color palette of the film. The theme of rebirth and rebirth being caused by a death is central to Talk to Her and somewhat mirrors the cultural rebirth of Spain after the death of Franco. In a general sense, La Movida may have influenced Almodóvar to continually push boundaries, explore taboo subjects, and play with gender and traditional images of power. The early 2000s. Whilst Almodóvar's films are firmly rooted in Spanish culture and are influenced by Spain's history, to a certain extent, the immediate social context of the early 2000s when it was made could be seen as fairly irrelevant, as Talk to Her can be considered quite classical and timeless in its messages and themes. Additionally, in the vein of many of his films, it could be considered fairly apolitical, in that is, does not engage with the social issues of everyday Spaniards. Sally Faulkner asserts that during the late 1990s, Almodóvar reinvented himself from a director working on shoestring budgets and with risky, sometimes grotesque subject matter, to a director who, as Faulkner asserts, made themselves much more appealing to the middlebrow, a middle-class and culturally literate audience. She states that this change occurred first with the film The Flower of My Secret, 1995, which took him from being an outsider to having an immeasurable contribution to the cultural prestige of modern Spain. Faulkner argues that this change owes as much to the institutional context in which Almodóvar's films were made as it does to Almodóvar's maturity as a director. During the 1990s, a system of government subsidy was set up in order to encourage greater quality within the Spanish film industry. Faulkner describes that the impact of this was to encourage a certain style of filmmaking. While the aim was change, whereby directors were freed from the constraints of censorship and lack of financing, the Film Protection Fund could easily be seen as a new form of censorship. Certain films were favored, others were discouraged. She states that the kind of films that were encouraged were left-wing with auteurist directors and the potential to win prizes at foreign film festivals, and quality cinema with high budgets. Although Talk to Her is not government-funded, unlike some of Almodóvar's other films, Talk to Her certainly fits many of the descriptions of the type of cinema that the Spanish government in the late 1990s, early 2000s were trying to cultivate. The film has an auteurist feel to it and was nominated for and won several awards, including a BAFTA, a Golden Globe, and an Academy Award. It could be seen to fit into the idea of quality cinema through its complexity, but also through the fact that the film's micro-elements of sound, cinematography, mise-en-scène, and editing can be thought of as technically proficient and visually pleasing. Writing for Sight and Sound magazine, Paul Julian Smith says that Talk to Her signals the start of a new, ambitious and risky period for Almodóvar, commenting upon the change to a more subtle, complex and artistic phase in his career. This phase would continue into his subsequent critically acclaimed films Bad Education, Vulva, 2006, Broken Embraces, 2009, The Skin I Live In, and end somewhat with I'm So Excited, 2013, which is potentially less subtle, more flamboyant and brash perhaps in the style of his earlier films. Almodóvar's Club. Almodóvar both writes and directs his films and keeps things in the family, with many of his films being produced by his brother Augustine. Almodóvar likes to use many of the same crew and the same actors in his films, and indeed, in one scene where Marco and Lydia are listening to Spanish guitar music, a scene that does little to develop the plot, The camera pans through the audience, revealing actresses from his previous films, Marisa Paredes' The Flower of My Secret, The Skin I Live In, and Dark Habits, 1983, and Cecilia Roth of Labyrinth of Passion, 1982, All About My Mother, Dark Habits, and Who Would Go On to Be In I'm So Excited. The film also has a cameo from Chus Lampreve, another of Almodóvar's favored actresses, who plays Benigno's building manager. One gets the sense from scenes like these that Almodóvar is not only the darling of the Spanish film industry, but his auteur status is like a club with similar actors, crew, and settings featuring across several of his films. El Deseo. Unlike most Hollywood directors, whose status as an auteur can often be brought into question by the mediation of cast and crew and the pressures of the producer and the studio, Almodóvar owns his own movie studio. Founded in 1985-6, El Deseo, meaning desire, was set up initially to produce Law of Desire, 1987, and has produced all of Almodóvar's subsequent films. Not only does this allow Almodóvar and his brother Augustine to direct and produce their own films, but they are also able to enhance Spanish cinema as a whole, as they help support, produce and fund films made by other Spanish and Latin American directors such as Guillermo del Toro's The Devil's Backbone, 2001, which was produced by Augustine Almodóvar and executive produced by Pedro Almodóvar. Upon visiting El Deseo, journalist Adam Woodward, writing for Little White Lies magazine, writes about the creative environment at the studio, describing it as a sensual banquet, a kaleidoscopic metropolis of color and light. The place has an infectious, harmonious energy about it. El Deseo is significant in considering Almodóvar as an auteur. Like other auteur directors who own their own companies such as Quentin Tarantino, Band Apart, Baz Luhrmann, Bazmark Inc., and Ridley Scott, Scott Free, Almodóvar is able to cultivate a creative space in his own vision which fits his own requirements as a filmmaker. As Paul Julian Smith notes from a private conversation with Augustine Almodóvar, owning their own film production company allows for their films to be shot in sequence, i.e., in roughly the chronological order that they will appear in the film, thus following the natural development of character and narrative. This way of filming rarely occurs in Hollywood cinema, whose productions are restricted by tight financial budgets, crew and cast's diaries, locations and strict timeframes. In Talk to Her, characters like Benigno and Alicia not only transform as characters, but also physically transform, so filming in this way arguably adds a depth and richness to the performances. Challenges to seeing Almodóvar as an auteur. As much as Talk to Her has many of the hallmarks of an Almodóvar film, the film poses some interesting challenges in being seen as an auteur film. To a certain extent, Almodóvar breaks patterns within Talk to Her. Almodóvar is often described as a women's director or an LGBTQ director. Talk to Her disrupts this trend by having two heterosexual males as the main protagonists. The film as a whole could be described as a tale of male friendship with women talking on a lesser role, and homosexuals non-existent within the plot. Secondly, arguably the style that Almodóvar makes his films in, filming in chronological order, means that much of the craft in structuring the narrative lies with his editor José Salcedo, who also worked on Volva and All About My Mother. Thus El Deseo and its regular crew might better be given auteur status than just Almodóvar alone. Indeed, in his interview in Little White Lies, he acknowledges the impact that others have had on his films, stating, "I don't have that certainty when I start a film because a film is a living being itself, it has a life of itself, and it's full of other people as well. Those people can also influence the direction that the film moves in, and you have to be constantly keeping tabs and making sure you're in control of the film in case it's been led elsewhere." Equally, as most of Almodóvar's films have been produced by his brother Augustine, we could consider the auteur status to be attributed to a partnership in the style of other sibling auteurs such as the American directors Joel and Ethan Coen. Although Talk to Her has some aspects which are unmistakably Almodóvarian, such as gaudy interior decor, melodramatic acting and brash, colorful characters, Talk to Her as a whole is arguably less floridly flamboyant and brash than some of his earlier films. The film is arguably more sensitive, with more depth to its characters. References. 1. Julian Smith, Paul. 2014, Desire Unlimited, The Cinema of Pedro Almodóvar. London Verso. Page 5. 2. DeLugo, Marvin. 2006, Contemporary Filmmakers, Pedro Almodóvar. USA, University of Illinois Press. 3. Jordan, Barry and Allenson, Mark, 2005, Spanish Cinema Student's Guide. London, Hodder, Arnold. Page 6. 4. Faulkner, Sally. 2013, A History of Spanish Film, Cinema and Society, 1910-2010. London, Bloomsbury Academic. Page 17. 5. Lannan, Francis. 2003, The Spanish Civil War, 1936-1939. Oxford Osprey Publishing. Page 7. 6. Jordan, Barry and Allenson, Mark. Page 15. 7. Faulkner, page 17. 8. Paula Willow K. Maricandi. 2004, Pedro Almodóvar, Interviews. USA University Press of Mississippi. P. She. 9. Almodóvar, quoted in the introduction to Pepe Lucci, Bomb on the Optimum DVD, Almodóvar Collection, Volume 1. 10. Mackenzie, Susie and Ed. Paula Willow K. Maricandi. 2004, Pedro Almodóvar, Interviews. USA University Press of Mississippi. Page 155. 11. Faulkner, page 217. 12. Faulkner, page 162. 13. Faulkner, page 161. 14. Faulkner, page 161. 15. Julian Smith, page 174. 16. Woodward, Adam. The 23rd of August 2011, Pedro Almodóvar, www.littlewhitelies.co.uk/features/articles/pedro-almodóvar16259, access the 14th of September 19. 17. Julian Smith, page 4. 18. Woodward, Ibid. Mise-en-scène and Cinematography. Intertext Duality. Almodóvar had no formal training within film, and as a consequence, he has learned his craft by watching films as an avid cinephile. Almodóvar's mise-en-scène is rich with intertextual references, whether it be from high culture, with his inclusion of choreography from the renowned choreographer Pina Bausch at the start and end of Talk to Her, through the pastiche of other films such as The Devil Doll.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.